The views expressed on this Turnbuckle Tabloid live stream or Turnbuckle Tabloid podcast episode do not reflect the views, thoughts, or opinions of the RageWorks brand, including the RageWorks podcast network, RageWorks content partners, advertisers, and affiliates. Viewer and listener discretion is advised.
This is something that not only it's a really cool vibe event, but it's one of those things where you can support not only wrestling but also the, I guess, the reemergence of what wrestling should be. And we'll get into the whole aspect of why and how this event occurred, but This is an event of No Justice, No Peace. An event that me, usually I'll be a hater of this shit. But like, fuck this bullshit. But not because you're family, but because when I watch,
and I allow that for sure.
And I said, I go,
you know me,
guy. Yeah, yeah, of course, because you know me. I'm like, yeah. Dude, what the fuck are you doing?
Yeah, yeah.
Keep it real.
No, but honestly, this is an event that I said with hard work, persistence, and everything. It could have been a shit show, but this is so. Yo, my little brother. I gave him a little pass, and he was like, dude, this shit is fucking awesome, man.
Yeah, yeah.
This shit was so cool. And I'm like, wow, when you get that audience, that's exactly what you want.
Yeah.
You want that audience to really. And then when I told them the story about what happened, and I was like, wow, they were able to pull it off. That's great. We'll get to that in a second, but yeah. Now you have a vast connection with these wrestlers, and you have a connection with promoters. What is the biggest hiccup when you're dealing with guys like this? Because honestly, being as a podcaster and doing the shit, I always think that I'm cool with somebody to get the interviews, and Olskey goes to the same shit, and all of a sudden shit goes flat. It's like, yeah. What the fuck? We go.
it could die out very quickly.
As a booker or promoter, what's the biggest hiccups you deal with?
You have to understand the person, and you have to listen to the person, especially if it's a talent that, like I said, a lot of the reason for like the connections I have, like we're all nowadays the same age bracket. You know, so we do have that instant connection.
Yeah.
So it makes it easier to communicate to these guys. But everyone's different. This guy could be a dick. This guy could be the nicest person ever. But you just have to listen, especially as a promoter. You got to be someone that is able to listen, able to feel out how this person rolls. You know, everyone's different. So I think the biggest hiccup is probably just a vibe. You know, everyone has a different vibe, and everybody is... they're different. You know?
I think you're better than me, because a lot of times I get some asshole.
I have too much patience.
So. You're real good. And I have patience too, but there's a certain level where I just, yeah. If you give me this prima donna shit, I'll be like,
I get it.
Fucker!
But yeah.
But you know what I think that it's actually a really important thing to note. Most of the guys that were on that VxS card are kind of our age. So I think when they're speaking to a booker like Isaac, and they're having a conversation about a vision,
yeah.
Having that same age demographic, and then being able to be like, yo, you could be my boy. Like, I'm not going to lie. I speak to Isaac every day. He became friends with these dudes. I don't know if I want to name drop them, but like...
Yeah,
No.
No, don't do it? You don't want to do it? Friends.
Yeah, I know. Whatever. For business wise. Nah.
Yeah.
Friends. And they they become cool, and it becomes a partnership on the same goal and same vision, which, like I said, the age demographic, I don't know. Isaac could agree with me on that. It makes a big difference.
No, it does, but like I learned recently, it's always about there's two. Either you're going to fuck them, or you're going to fuck... Oh, they're gonna fuck you.
Yeah.
It's one of those.
Yeah.
You gotta. That's what the business is like, and especially wrestling. That's what it is. Look, there's many times that we here in Turnbuckle Tabloid have been promised certain things and we don't get it. And it's like,
whatever.
All right, whatever.
Ain't Christmas today.
We'll get it. Same whatever here. The case may be. It's fine. And you get it. It's the same. And that's what it is. But the fact of the matter is, if you go into the business with a mindset of, look, I'm going to take an L for a lot of this shit. And this past weekend, you took a lot of L's in one day.
Oh, tell me about it. It was crazy.
We'll talk about it in a second, but the business is going, and people always think that they can be a booker or a promoter and all this shit, and it's like, no, you talk all this shit on social media, like you know what the fuck the business is, and you don't know shit. You have no clue. Was that the idea when you were sitting there going in social media and bashing some other promotion or whatever the case may be?
Yeah, absolutely shooting on everybody. Yeah, fuck this promote. Yeah, like leading up to it, you could tell like I wanted to change how every promoter was very gritty, very, very greedy, very, they don't have any relationship with all their workers and shit like that. Like, it's just being dicks, you know? It's so hard to be a fucking decent human being is what I'm talking about. So if you're trying to have some type of relationship with these guys that are going to be on TV next year, you got to fucking act right and fucking listen, you know what I'm saying? So you just got to... You just got to go with the flow.
One of the biggest stories that I heard, I was listening to a Sean Oliver's kayfabe, was he had a big booking with Bruno Sammartino, right?
And,
Bruno Sammartino. I only go to the WWF because they offered me the money for the Hall of Fame. But it's great that we were all there.
Great.
So he tells a story about...
Fuck you.
Sean Oliver tells a story about he had a big lined promotion for KFA commentaries. And the big one, the lead off was Bruno. And he talks about how at the same time that occurred, while everything was lined up, WWE calls and they want him for the Hall of Fame. And now he can't do
shit
anything because of WWE. Bruno, beforehand, and the old school shit, had given him the handshake. It's like, listen, because of whatever, I'll come back and do your show. And they were throwing him tons of money. And Bruno told WWE, I'm not going to go to the Hall of Fame unless I do this because I honored him with the handshake.
Wow.
And they were trying to throw him double the money to say, yo, I'll give you the money, get out of this. And she's like, no, I honored this.
What a man. That's some gentleman shit.
And I think about it with you as an up-and-coming individual in wrestling. It's like you need to realize that the game may or may not have changed because of that. What is the biggest hiccups that you think that you're going to see from here on out when you're booking or you're part of this progression of VxS?
Man, there's a lot. You know, I obviously went through a lot, too.
COVID! Besides the COVID!
Man,
already been through hiccups.
Communication. You have to deal with a lot of people going into stuff like this.
Yeah.
And it's keeping book, communication.
They have their own agents, right? And
some people do. Yeah. Right? Like the ex-WWE guys, some of them do.
Yeah.
TNA used to, but not anymore. Tony Khan has an agent that connects people with like talent from AEW.
Yeah.
Which I'm very grateful for. When Nick Gage got injured, that was a really clutch move from them. Mm. We requested Brian Cage. Mm. Brian Cage from Tony. And, like, Tony paid for the flight, dude. He was, like, completely all in for it. And it was really cool to see stuff like that. Listen, you got
helping the community out, man.
Communication is probably the biggest hiccup because the anxiety, like, hits. And you really got...
That's been hard, right?
And you got...
You didn't know that you had to deal with that, right?
Not at all. And you have to be prepared. And you really have to be hungry for this shit. If you're not hungry,
you can't miss an email. You can't miss a text. You can't miss none of that shit.
It's unreal. I was, like, next to Matt. I'm, like, always on my phone. I just feel so bad, you know?
No, it's all good,
bro. There'll be some times like that. You got to be on point.
No, literally, you know we're on FaceTime, like, and we're playing GTA, and all of a sudden, his car stops. We're in the middle of a heist, and his car stops. I was like, yo, what happened? It's like, yo, I'm calling you. I got to go right now.
Lesson learned. He does not, he's not allowed to drive anymore.
Oh, believe me. You know, the amount of times me and Mark have gone back after a heist and seen this dude in the corner.
Yo, always stop. Always stopped.
But that's a good thing to think about. Like, you're still a kid. You're still young.
Yeah. Everyone says that. I got it.
And you do a lot of other things. How is it that you've been able to balance all this shit, man?
I have no clue. I set days of the week. It changes. My schedule changes every week, honestly.
I tell you know, because I have ideas for the show, and I said, you know, I want to do this. I'm going to have some graphic for here, whatever the case may be. And, you know, Matt will be like, I'll see what Isaac. I said, you know what? Don't bother him. I know he has a lot of shit going on.
Isaac's a busy dude.
And you know what? 9 times out of 10, boom, he always finds a way for us. And I love that. And I go, if I was in his shoes, I'd be like, man, fuck this shit, man.
I'm not doing extra homework.
Yeah, I'm doing this shit. But now we have the first show's out the way. We're going to get to that in a second. Guys, check out VxS, Violence is Sufferings, No Justice, No Peace on...
No Feats.
No Feats.
There you go.
Violence is Sufferings, No Justice, No Peace.
Put that over.
It's on Fight. Guys, check it out. You don't want to miss it. It's such a fucking...
It's a fun time.
No Justice, No Peace. It's for the amputees.
Oh, God.
What? It's wrong.
What?
That's wrong. No Justice, No Peace. Check it out on Fight. It's still available.
No legs!
For a show that shouldn't have happened, it happened.
Unreal.
So check it out on Fight. It's awesome, man. You guys do not want to you don't want to miss a show that actually people didn't want to happen in, but it happened. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pish.
Yeah.
And I want you guys to go into the whole scenario. What the fuck happened on the night? No Justice, No Peace.
Yo.
Olskey, you were there live.
I was, and I'll tell you.
I'm proud of you guys. You guys did a great job.
Thank you.
So, Olskey was there live and in person. So, you guys can have the banter on what happened. So, explain what happened that night.
Oh, man. Listen,
it's 9 in the morning.
Yeah, before we go anywhere, I got to say, like...
I got tears in my face.
I'm crying right now. Because
it's like, it's a movie. It's a
movie.
It's literally, you can't make up what happened that day.
You can't make this shit up.
And Matt, for Matt's first road trip, like, to the show, this was unreal.
It was unreal. So before I start anything, I want to say, like, you know...
Holy fuck.
Like Ray just said, check the show out. If you haven't, please do. And that was the first show I watched twice in a row. I watched it live, and I watched it live.
You fucked with it? You can be honest.
I loved it, dude. I loved it. And
as long as you people fuck
and
with
it. And I hope you know, like, I think since day one, like, I've been a part of the team, like, helping you out creatively and all that. And big I was so of proud of this show, regardless of what happened. So let's just start it off with the first off, we don't have a ride, so we figure out we're riding with a few other guys, and we're like, all right, we'll figure it out. Yeah. So
Giuseppe the ref pulled up to Bushwick, and everybody came through. We had in the car Giuseppe, me,
Nick
Karp, Richard Ruiz, and Matt Olskey over here.
The gang was all there.
All crammed up in this little hamster ass.
Yeah. Isaac goes, this guy has mad room in his car. I'm like, ass is sitting on cup holders.
I forgot there was like 3 people last time I went in that.
My ass was sitting in cup holders. All of a sudden, literally my ass was in cup holders.
I wake up. And I get a call at, it is like 8 a.m. And I didn't tell the guys till like they got here and shit. So like it's like 8 a.m. I wake up and I get the call like the police are at the location.
Yep.
And I'm like, what the fuck?
So I FaceTime Isaac. I'm trying to. And he hangs
I'm like,
up on
yo, but guys, you got to wait. And they're like, oh, already on our way. I'm like, fuck. They're in front of my house.
Yep. And so what happened was I try calling up Isaac and he doesn't answer. And he goes, yo. The cops are at the location.
I'm having a heart attack at this point. This is like the first thing that I have to encounter in 8 in the morning.
And here's the problem. Medium ref, Giuseppe, he's already there. Isaac's like, shit, I haven't even figured out if we're having the show or not.
Guys are in front of my house. I walk outside with fucking French toast and a plate.
My son had
walked out with French toast, and I gave everybody the news, like, yo, listen, the cops are at the fucking...
My dude was eating his breakfast on a fucking plate outside
of Boyd's. I had no time that morning at all. I fucking grabbed my plate and just ran to talk with you guys at the stoop.
It was unreal. It was crazy. So, you know, we find out that the location might have to be changed, but we decide, let's just go to New Jersey and meet and just go there. So,
I got information, like, the ropes broke. The first set of ropes broke.
I didn't know that. You found out at the same time.
That was the same time about the police, yeah. So I got to find another ring, fucking pair of ring ropes.
Wait, so your brand new ropes broke already?
They're not brand new, no. They were used.
Oh, they were used?
Yeah.
Son of a bitch.
Both of them were used. Both of them were used. I think that's why we got them. They just said, fuck it. They said, fuck this show, and give us broken ropes.
What happened to the new ring you bought?
That was the ring. It was a logo. And it's good. They gave us the wrong
wrong ropes to the ring. Yeah.
Wrong ropes, wrong canvas.
So not only the police were called on the event.
But we got a broken fucking
broken
ring.
Ropes. So. Yeah.
So we're in the fucking little mini hamster. Yeah, and
this was at 8 o'clock in the morning.
Yes,
8 o'clock in the morning. Fast forward 9 o'clock. We're in the middle of Jersey. Get a phone call. What was the next shit that happened, man?
We went to some stop. I got a tuna melt. We were eating shit. And all of a sudden, Isaac looks at me and goes, "Yo, I'm not gonna lie." And I don't know if you. This is whatever. Isaac looks across from me and goes, "Bro, I'm gonna be honest with you. We're not supposed to be at this venue right now. I'm about to just go there and bite the bullet and take this fucking fine." Dude.
I gave Matt the craziest look. This was like, I think like a half hour after we got the news and started driving. We started driving and we're like, let's just drive until we figure out what the fuck's gonna happen. We made a stop like somewhere in Jersey at like a pit stop and got some fucking Auntie Anne. Shout out Auntie Anne's. That shit was fucking woo! I need that shit.
And Isaac saw shit and dipped.
Oh, I'm going to say here right now, I'm also pro-cannabis, so I like it helped a lot, actually, to like keep composure that day.
Well, wait a minute.
Go.
Wasn't the venue in like a private property kind of thing?
Which one?
The original venue.
I'll tell you the scoop on that. The first, La Granja. Which people don't know, the farm in Spanish, you fucks.
No.
It's like a rib. It's a whole rib. But anyway, so it's a private property. Is it on? It's a private property. Mm. And we got the police called like early in the fucking morning. And we were told like it's unacceptable to have this many cars. Because, yo, there were fans there in the morning.
Yeah, no, they were there before they were there even anything. Before. It was bananas.
I wasn't even there. And there was like about like 70 heads over there. And then the cops were like taking photos and shit. Hello?
Yeah.
So yeah, the cops were taking photos and shit like that with the fans, and they were like, "This isn't acceptable and shit. You need the right permits and all that other shit." Someone cop called. Someone snitched. It was because the location originally was sent like separately through email to everyone that purchased a ticket. So
undisclosed location.
Yeah. But it was like whatever. But I didn't know. I didn't expect this. You know. So. That's on me, but I was like taking deep breaths and I was contacting everyone I knew in Philly. I was contacting wrestlers I knew in Philly that helped out. We got another location that's outdoors in a parking lot.
No, so this is what happened. So Isaac tells me, he looks at me, he goes,
"It's like every 20 minutes something happens.
Something bad happens." So he was like,
"Every 20 minutes."
He was like, "You know what? I might just bite the bullet and get a fine." But then we get a call again.
Yeah.
Finding out that we can't even be in Burlington, period.
Oh yeah, am I on?
Yeah.
Next call I get, I'm like fucking banned from the whole city of Burlington apparently.
Burlington,
New Jersey.
Like whoever called, right?
It was a snitch.
He didn't call just the police. He called like the
creme. This was a specific hit.
He called the creme de la creme of sheriffs in New Jersey. Like he went to the top of the
heap. And the sheriff didn't care. I was told like the sheriff didn't even give a fuck. It was just like they don't know what's going on. So this is obviously like learning steps for me, you know, to like contact the city first, make everyone aware, especially with like COVID going on and shit.
It got so bad we started laughing. The whole group just started laughing. We were like, what the fuck?
I was
fuck?
So close to like just like fucking calling it quits multiple times that day, but.
Someone, because I remember someone told you to email people the new venue, and you were like, "I might have to email them saying
that." Because we didn't confirm it yet.
Yeah, so.
And then it changed again.
It changed like three times.
Because someone called somehow on the second location, they found out, which only like three people knew, so.
That's suspect. I don't know about that, yeah. But then we found out that there was a venue in Philly that was.
Oh, my God, 20 minutes from the original.
20 minutes from the original arena, and it all worked out, but. Basically, we were driving to Philly, calling every single U-Haul company in the state, for a last minute you all talk. Yes. Because think about it. We had to take the ring from the Burlington. Original location.
Now we have to fucking go to Philly.
Bring it to Philly.
So in like 20 minutes, I had to rent a fucking U-Haul truck to drive to Burlington and back in Philly and then drop
like
it off again. $500.
$500. Because one person called the fucking cops. We had to spend $500 more dollars for a U-Haul.
And that's just the beginning.
Okay, so fast forward. We're in Philly.
Yeah.
Yeah, Hiccup's talent had to leave. You had to do all this, right?
People find out about the final third location, and it's like a abandoned Chinese buffet.
Yeah, it was abandoned. Dude,
it was the G-est shit ever. I owned to this shit, man.
The only thing I asked Olskey during all day, I said, do they have electricity? That's the only thing I asked, and he said yes.
But no Wi-Fi, so I got to call Fight.
Yeah.
And then that's fucked, and that's another thing from another hour. So like that. Right. So now I can't even. It was supposed to be an hour delay. Found out there's no signal at all in that area. Right. Fucked.
Think about it. The show
my stream
was,
fucked.
The show was supposed to start. The show was supposed to start at 3, and it was like 4:30, and we're like, what the fuck is going on?
Yeah.
So
it's fucked.
I like I said, do they have electricity? Because you're by a Walmart, and you might have to get fucking lights. And he's like, no, they got electricity. I said, that's all that matters right now. That's it. Get the electricity.
Because it'll get dark real quick.
Yeah. No. We had spotlights.
You got to run a show with lights. Yeah, it has to be lights.
Okay, so I get the ring. I get the ring from Burlington. I get another set of ropes. I check out the other set of ropes.
Don't fit.
They're fucking broken and they don't fit. I used the 18 by 18 ring.
Right.
And that was perfect, but the canvas was 20 by 20.
20 by 20.
So I had to buy. I had to go to Walmart now and buy extra tarp strings.
Right.
And then tighten that bitch up.
And it wasn't happening.
They made it workable, but I wasn't comfortable with it. And then I went to the back. I told the guys, yo, if you're not comfortable, I completely understand.
Right.
I'll still pay you. Tony Deppen was with his wife who's pregnant, dude. So I was like, yeah, I'll obviously accommodate. No problem, Tony. Like, fucking, he was the coolest dude ever. You got to talk to Orlando and talk about the situation. Like,
right.
I get it. Like, dude, your wife is pregnant. You don't want to go in this place.
And plus, you have other obligations and shit like that.
Yeah, Ring of Honor coming up, and then you got fucking Davey Boy Smith came.
Davey Boy.
He pulled up. I think 40 minutes after he pulled up, MLW somehow got a photo of the location and pulled him out. So yeah, people.
That's another snitch.
People weren't happy about
someone
that.
Else snitched. Someone sent a picture to MLW.
Yeah.
But it's what
everyone,
I'm telling you.
Everyone heard about our event though.
Yeah, everyone.
But it's what I'm telling you.
People are fucking crazy.
Yeah, snakes
in the grass.
It's a crazy world, especially like Philly, dude. Like, that's how the scene is, you know?
Yeah, my motherfuckers is kill or be kill out
at this
there,
point,
man.
I'm like, fuck, we lost our main event, and there's the ropes both broke, and that, like...
It was absolutely a train wreck.
Like 10 minutes before bell time, I was going to quit the whole event. I was going to cut it.
10 minutes before?
Yeah, and then I saw them take out... The ropes were already pre, like... They're already, like, kind of up there, so they're taking out the broken-ass ropes. Fuck that shit. They take out the broken-ass ropes. They're taking out the turnbuckles, and I see him take him out, and then I look at the ring, like, for a real good second. Matt's next to me. I'm just there staring at the fucking ring. I'm like, you know what? I know this fucking crazy, and our card is full of high flyers, but let's just do something so different. Get the stream over with so we have something to deliver and not make anybody upset.
Right.
Yeah, and that's when the fight club idea.
And 100% at every moment, I was like thinking about the fans and thinking about the people in Germany that ordered and people in the UK that ordered, you know, and that was my whole, was what's on my head the whole time. I wanted to get it done. You know, I wanted the boys to eat. And we had to turn back, unfortunately. Like, luckily, I pre-sold about 70 tickets and, you know, we ended up like pushing away like 50, 60 people because of the space we started getting, and I didn't want to cram it like ICW did in that barn. I did not want to do that.
That pit fight.
I'm very grateful for everybody that got to stay during that experience, but also like respectfully social distance with their masks on the complete event. So
let me tell you, I said it's rare that you could get anybody who could pour syrup on shit and make it pancakes.
I tell everybody this: if you're in a tough situation, if you have chicken shit. Make it into Caesar salad.
Or make chicken salad.
Chicken shit to chicken salad. I remember there was a time during the day where Isaac pulled me aside and said, "Yo, I might have to cancel the show." And I was like, "Nah, there's got to be." But I'll tell you, dude, Isaac, your head was up the entire time. You didn't put your head down. You worked your ass off, and you were still professional. But I will say one thing. When everyone started becoming down on and like in the wrestler morale, I'm not gonna lie, for a second got pretty low.
Yeah.
I got to give a quick shout out to these men because Facade, Eli Everfly, and Alex Zane were in that ring with no ropes, looking at each other going, how the fuck we make a five-star match with this? Yeah. And they worked for 3 hours in that ring figuring out what to do to help my man Isaac put on a good show. They did not leave that ring from rehearsing or doing whatever until hour before showtime.
And it's
they
the whole
busted team their
effort.
Ass. Every single member of that roster looked at each other and said, yo, we're here. How we can make this a good show? How can we make this a five-star?
That's family right there. That's not just like people you're getting. Like, that's legit people you want on your roster.
Even Nick Gage showed up and said, I'm here.
Out of nowhere. Out of nowhere. Nick Gage with his fucking boot because he's injured.
Yeah, tell the story about that. What did Nick Gage say when he came in?
Like, hey, what's like, up, man? Listen, if you want me to do fucking so, you let me know. I said, I'm on your fucking team, man. MDK.
I'm like, go on commentary.
MDK all day, dog.
Yeah,
you know?
I originally wanted Joe Cronin on, but he never made it, and he didn't fucking come with MLJ, and MLJ was there looking like mad lonely and shit. So I was like, you know what? Rotate with Larry Legend and Nick Gage. And he's like, got it. I'll take it. I'll
did
take
a good
care
job.
Of it. I'll take care of it. I was like, listen, just be raw as you could and just fucking have fun.
Are you a fan of Gage commentary?
Everyone just wanted to
have fun. I had a good time with him. I really did. Yeah. He was cool.
I think that gave it a purpose for people to get the stream as well because of how fucking entertaining he is.
Yeah.
How
cool. Just,
and how laid back and how fucking.
Look, man, I'm going to tell you right now, that's a big fuck. That's a big move right there.
He did say, I don't care how big you are. That shit fucking hurts.
Like how Samoa Joe's doing his gimmick on SmackDown. That's how we consider Nick Gage and ours, you know? That's how I see it.
So when you finally put this on under wraps, you put it in the bed, and it's like
crazy.
Do I really want to do this again?
Yeah. Knowing the steps now, I do, but it did burn me out. Like it burnt me out. Like the next 2 days, I was completely like just done.
You were in bed all day.
I was telling myself, like, I don't know if I want to do this and shit. But then I thought about, man, maybe that's what the fucking person wanted me to do. And that just drives me more. You know what
I'm saying? But that's what it is.
I really like, if I see potential in something that I know could be super successful, I'm going to put 100% effort on it. I could attest with, like, people like you guys that fucking kill it every week with this podcast. People like fucking the vignettes I did for ICW every week. That was a crazy journey doing that first No Holds Barred. And just like innovating, you know, like that's the whole game. You gotta be different. And I was just trying to be different in that situation.
No, I'm happy that you say that because a lot of motherfuckers will sit there and be like, you know what? I'm done.
And there was like hit after hit, dude. Hit after hit. And it was unreal.
You were
like,
throwing the entire arsenal, bro.
I understand people were like so fucking tight about it and shit, but I was at that mindset of like, yo, I'm not gonna let them win, and I just want it over with. But then moving forward, I'm like, you know what? What if we didn't have the situation? What if things went to fruition and it would have been fucking
amazing?
What is
the thing that makes you a break?
Live and learn.
Yeah, exactly. A lot of learning. Like I said, you never stop learning, and this is a pure example of it, and I'm so grateful for like the high demand people wanted the event to happen to. Like I was expecting the worst. I was like, yo, I'm not gonna check my phone at all that night.
Yeah, I remember you told me.
I was like, Matt, check the internet for me. I was like, oh, word.
We got in the car, and he was like, you know what? I'm already getting reviews of this shit because I'm going to bed, and he like knocked out in the car because he didn't want to.
I wake up, there's like 5 articles about it, one in Spanish. And I was like, holy, this is a fucking
once you get it from Mexico, you know it's real.
Yes, and it was awesome.
And you know, I was watching the next day because, you know, after the whole thing with Fight, we had to move the show to the next day, pre-recorded. But the overall reviews were outstanding. On the stream I was watching, it was nothing but positive comments. Everyone loved the no rope. People said that.
And I was like on the fly, honestly. I had no intention ripping off Underground or Bloodsport.
Yeah, no.
But I do think if you're going to deliver in something entertaining, you want to do it as different as possible and have fun.
I mean, what could you do?
You can't do shit because the ropes are done now. And you know what?
You made the best of it.
And I'll say right now, if an old head carny-ass promoter ran that show, he would have kept those ropes up.
I know. He would have took his money and left.
He would have kept those ropes up and injured everyone
in
that
place. Facts. I remember.
And I would never do that.
I remember you said, if the ropes are broken, we're not using them. I don't care if you fucking glue them together. We're not using them.
If there's a split in anywhere, there's not going to be a chance of this fucking show happening.
Yeah, but, the guys that you had, the talent that you had made it happen.
yeah, I'm very grateful for the guys. Yeah. They're all in, basically. Like I can't be thankful enough for them.
It's tough, man, because you know, like I said, a lot of motherfuckers would have sat there, threw their hands in the air, took the money, and just walked away.
Lost a lot of money that night.
Yeah, but you also gain a lot of respect, and that's what I think that really matters. Now that you're not video game booking, and I'm not gonna sit there and sorry, hold on, it's the headphones. Oh.
Hello.
Now we're here.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, no, okay. We're here. Yeah. We're not gonna do video game booking or whatever, but I have to ask: is it worth it? Is it worth it?
Yes.
Kissing this.
Yes, because I believe we were something that people wanted to silence. I believe like there was a lot of motive towards it, and I believe the event this past Sunday was like completely sabotaged. And I think we ended up walking away with a big W, I must say. I don't know if you agree, Olskey.
Big time. I think it was a great success.
You know, there's a lot of fucking haters, like you were saying, in this industry. There's a lot of fucking snakes. And
hold on, sorry. You hear me?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Oh my god.
It's me. I'm over here with the fucking.
It's okay. We're just trying to fix audio, guys. Yeah. But there's a lot of fucking snakes you can't trust, man. So like, I surround myself around people that want like difference and want change. Like people like Jordan Oliver, people like Jimmy Lloyd. They grew up having that same mindset. Like, yo, there's some corny fucking people backstage. You have talent like photographers that say shit like that. People that don't get paid. Like, I believe in a system where like production gets paid. I didn't get a penny my whole time at House of Glory. And, you know, that just speaks volumes because, like, everything about that place was so special and shit like that. But you got to take care of the people that take care of you.
It's all about the groundwork.
All about the groundwork. And it's business.
Yeah.
It's business at the end of the day. And if I would do it again, yes, but correctly this time.
How's been the support from the fan base, social media and all that?
The support's been like overwhelming, really. It's been nothing but positive shit.
People save clips.
Oh, that's awesome.
Loved it.
There's obviously like the white crab.
The white crab account.
Well, listen, unfortunately, people made fake accounts to fucking hate. Well, what? Basically, the biggest
saltiness.
It was just saltiness.
It's just like, I get that we had a very fast come up with this one show, but it's like, it shouldn't be in like dark light for saltiness. Like, we just want everybody to fucking succeed in this game and offer something different. So
especially for the boys.
And at the end of the day, that's all I hope, that I offer something different for the fans to enjoy.
Yeah, especially for the boys. The boys are the ones that are losing out if you got motherfuckers calling on a promotion to get money.
Yeah, you're taking money not just from them, but for me. And like, we have like a whole vision we want to do in the positive.
Listen, I'll take an L for me. Yeah. Not for the boys, man. They're the ones that's out there making money. They got shit to do.
They were not happy. People were not happy.
And they don't deserve that. They didn't deserve at all what happened.
When you take money out of my income, it's a problem. And that's how I think of things.
Sure. They come from different states. They got kids they have to feed and all that shit. It's like, dude, just because you have a fucking... You have a axe to grind because you're not happy about something. It's like, dude, you were one of the boys, or you are one of the boys.
A lot of people
are
fake.
What are you doing?
A lot of people are fake and childish.
But like I said before, for the longest time, I said, you can't fucking trust anybody.
Nope.
And whatever.
Yeah.
It's a rough game. It's a rough business. It's a rough business.
Politics-free zone.
I watch even in
But Red, when it comes to that, like in terms of giving Isaac future advice, do you think it's true when you watch the U shoots and they, you know, they do the dick bag segments and they go to like Vince McMahon and Paul Heyman and they go, yeah, he was a dick, but because of the business and how you can't trust anyone, you kind of have to be.
You kind of have to be, and it's also a measure of where
guard up.
How you deal with individuals, like even at work. I have to deal with it where people are like, oh, that person's an asshole. And I go, well, they haven't been a dick to me. I've been good because you know why?
Exactly.
I do good business.
Yep.
So it's, like I mentioned earlier, it's
business.
Who you fuck
mm-hmm.
and how you get fucked. And it's how you measure it.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, when it comes to wrestling, your talent, when you're coming in, has to be comfortable with what's going on and you lay it out on the line what it is that you need from them and what they want, what you want from them, and then that's it. If they're not willing to do business, you be like, thank you for your time. I'll get somebody else to do it, and that's it. And that's what it is. Be a big name, small name, or whatever. That's exactly what it is. There's many times I go to to do an interview with somebody or whatever, and I ask questions, then they go, oh, my fee is this. And I go,
yeah, all right.
Thanks for your time. I'll think about it. And I just leave them alone.
Respectfully.
Yeah. That's it.
Especially recently with some of the numbers we got.
Yeah, it's fine. It's okay.
It's business.
You know? But I before we wrap this up, I have to say that for what's going on right now, especially with the landscape, especially with the COVID and all this stuff, us as wrestling fans, we are missing what is necessary and needed for our entertainment and for our appreciation of the sport, because it's rare. And I hate to hear the fucking negativity when it comes to the realness of what true wrestling is, which is a startup, is in the independence, which is the machos, as Cornette would say. But I have to say that for what you have done in the past, not only the past years of you being a part of the business, but for what you did for this promotion, it takes a lot of balls, man, and a lot of people in your position might not have been able to take that. So I'm very proud of you, of how you're able to coincide and make something that could have been a disaster and show that wrestling is still here. And you can make it done, and I appreciate that you're able to do that. And it fucking sucks that you have to deal with haters.
Yeah.
And I hate to use that terminology because it's so fucking wasted. But individuals, envious, jealous motherfuckers who sat there and wanted to bury your shit. And like I've been saying for the longest.
Saw it coming.
It's the closest motherfuckers in your world that will turn their back and stab you in the fucking back because they're not getting what you're getting.
Yep.
So the only thing advice I can walk away with was this is always be wearful of those who fucking smile in your face and think you're cool, because they'll be the first one to take the knife and sit and stick it 6 deet in your back.
Once they see you succeed, they don't second guess that shit.
They don't want you to leave. You've done so much work for them. You did great things for them, and now all of a sudden you're ready to branch off, and you're a young kid who's able to make things up. Listen, like Stone Cold said, DTF, don't trust fuckers. No, it's DTA. Don't trust anyone, man. And that's what it is. Don't trust anyone.
Isaac, before we go, what would be your quick review of the last couple of months of the being in the role that you've been in, man. I mean, it's been a long journey. I've been there on the phone with you every day with it. But like, what would you want to tell our listeners in terms of like, how does it feel to be in the hot chair of putting together? What's your review, and like, what do you think you could do better? What's your review of yourself for the past couple of months?
I just want to like tell fans like, don't take stuff.
I have a new respect for that position in wrestling. Not everyone could do it and shit like that, you know, but I think it's something that I really have something different to offer. And like, if people want it, then I'm all for the people, you know. And and this Sunday, that was the whole motive, the whole mindset was like, man, I want to get this stream to the people that ordered this shit like overseas, like first show. Like, that's like a big fucking statement if you could pull that off. I don't know if I told you. I probably did tell you. Like, I used to throw in high school. I used to throw underground trap parties with my friend Eddie.
I know Eddie.
It was the biggest hustle ever. But a lot of that mentality comes from those days and just being prepared at any circumstance that goes with it. And just thank you to the fans, and thank you to the guys that I've been working with on VxS. So I don't know what's next, but it's getting interesting for sure, and I'm very grateful for the position. And now you only learn, you know? You can only learn.
Thank you, as always, my guy. That punk Isaac sits in, and
come on, my love.
Can I see your dick now?
Yo! You already did.
Okay, maybe later. What? All right, maybe later. So, guys, you always think that you could sit there and book or promote or be an angel, whatever, but you never fucking know what it is when you actually do it. you'll probably fold like origami and be like, you know what? I can't do this anymore. I'm going to go home.
Yeah.
Nah.
A lot of people talk the talk, but it's something when you walk the walk for sure.
Yeah.
That's not just a
slogan. And believe me, I've heard Isaac cry about shit before, but yeah. It's when he stood firm and he was a good man.
You all the respect, dude. All
right. So, guys, VxS, Violence and Suffering, our guy Isaac Rodriguez sitting in, shoot names. I had to drive the Rodriguez. Where did he get VxS at?
Look up VxS on social media at VxS Wrestling, Twitter, Instagram, same thing. You can follow me on Twitter at ThatPunkIsaac.
Guys, don't go over there. Stick around. And Turnbuckle Tabloid will return. Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but soon. See you guys in a second.
Turnbuckle Tabloid.
3, 2, 1.
Tabloid.